Macmillan Audio presents The People We Hate at the Wedding by Grant Ginder. Read for you by Kristen Bell and Dan Bittner. Part 1. Brothers and sisters should never be in the same family. Charles M. Schultz. Alice, May 1st. Christ, Alice thinks, staring at the envelope. These invitations must have cost a fucking fortune. Her phone buzzes against her desk, and she picks it up before it has a chance to ring twice. So, how much? It's Paul, her brother. Hold on. Alice scrolls down the website for a stationery company called Bella Laterna that she heard a coworker gushing about yesterday. Buried below 100 pictures of dainty thank you cards and save the dates, she finds what she's looking for, a pink and white pricing table for wedding invitations. I've only got about 5 minutes, he says. I'm going as fast as I can. She squints at the screen. Why are you in such a rush? I'm at work, okay? I've got shit to do. You're the one who was begging to talk last night. Yeah, and you said you were busy, just like I'm saying I'm busy now. So, she wasn't busy. That had been a lie. When she got home last evening, she'd had grand plans of going for a run in Laurel Canyon. Plans that were effectively squashed when she checked her mail and found, among the catalogs and bills, an invitation to her half-sister Eloise's wedding. She opened a bottle of white wine and dealt with the bills first. Or perhaps dealt is too strong, too ambitious a word. Really, she just stared at the crushing amounts her creditors were demanding. Then, when she was good and drunk, she leaned forward and ripped open the invitation, giving herself a nasty paper cut in the process. Shit, she'd said, and stared at the dot of blood on her finger as she waited for the sting to register. A few moments later, once the cut had got her satisfyingly angry, she shoved her finger into her mouth and sucked on it, cringing at the metallic taste. Her blood, she thought, the stuff that filled her body, was nothing but a fistful of pennies. Returning to her couch, she sat down and stared at the mess of paper in front of her. As a rule, she didn't believe in omens. She never reads her horoscope, and she thinks fate is just the name narcissists give to coincidence. Getting caught in a traffic jam, winning the lottery, dying in a plane crash, it's all just the slapdash workings of chance. Things happen and things don't. Still, though, slicing your finger open on your sister's wedding invitation can't be a good sign. Paul says, hello. I'm here. She skims down the table's columns, foil, no foil, cardstock type, multiple colors. So how much did they cost? Okay. Alice drums her fingers across her desk. In the cubicle next to her, the phone rings. Let's see, we think it's 2-ply paper, right? I think so. Paul says, I've got it right in front of me, thick and nice as shit. Yeah, I've got it right here too. Alice picks Eloise's invitation up off her desk. The paper is full and cottony, halfway between papyrus and a quilt, she thinks. And if she looks closely enough, she can see details she missed last night, wisps in its pulp, places where it's been hand-pressed, all sorts of little irregularities that add up to a hefty price tag. Paul says, okay, so we can agree on 2-ply? Absolutely. She traces her half-sister's name. How many colors are we dealing with? I was just going to ask that, Paul says. I count 3, gold, silver, and that terrible, shitty English seaside blue. Alice liked the blue when she first opened the envelope. It had reminded her of the peonies her mother used to grow in their garden in St. Charles. Right, she says. 3 colors. Do we think it's letterpress or foil stamping or what? Paul's breathing finally slows down. So, Mark and I were talking about this last night. He originally thought it was letterpress, but, I mean, if you look closely, you can pretty obviously see the foil. Alice closes her left eye and squints at the name of the groom, Oliver. The elegant O glints under the office's fluorescent lights. Definitely foil, she says. And we estimated how many? I'd say 250. That bitch knows a lot of people. I think that's probably reasonable. Alice reaches for a pen and a post-it, jots down a few numbers, and performs a series of mental calculations. So, we're looking at about 1,800, but that just covers the invitation, program cover, and program panel. She scrolls down to the site's next table. For response cards and the save the dates we got a few months ago and menus and all of that shit, we've got to consider another, looks about 1,500. So we're up to about 3,300. And then envelopes are going to run another 700 at least. Okay, so 4,000. Anything else? Alice does a quick inventory. No? I think that's it. We'll throw in an additional 500 because it's Eloise, which brings us up to $4,500, Paul says. And you're sure this website's legit, like it's analogous to something Elle would use? Totally. Alice lowers her voice to a whisper. The girl I overheard talking about it is a real fucking snob. Okay, good. So, $4,500 on invitations. Absolutely ridiculous. Alice examines her invitation again. At least they came out nicely. Well, they better have for nearly $5,000. You're acting surprised, aren't you? No, Alice says. We knew it would cost her at least that much. We just wanted to be justified in our disgust. Paul says, it's blood money, is what it is. You're being a little dramatic. Am I, though? Our entire childhood, her dad's funneling cash into some trust fund for her just because he feels guilty over what he did to Mom. He's her father. That's what rich fathers do. They give their daughters money, she adds, though she knows she shouldn't. And speaking of Mom, you should really give her a call, you know. I'm not getting into that, Alice. Do you hear me? I'm not getting into that. Anyway, we never saw a cent of that money. It wasn't ours, Paul. We didn't deserve any of it. She wants to believe herself. Paul scoffs. We went to a public school that looked like it was out of some D-rate John Hughes movie. She went to school, elementary school through high school, at Collège Alpin Beausoleil in Switzerland. We spent our fucking summers in Tampa. She spent hers in Santorini. Yeah, well, still, I'd much rather have had our dad for a father any day. Me too, he says. Alice tosses the invitation down on the desk. I can't remember the last time I thought this much about a piece of paper. You're at least going to go, aren't you? She asks, once she sat back down. Probably not, Paul says. Mark and I were already talking of plans that weekend. The wedding isn't until July 11th. And today's the 1st of May. So what's your point? What life-changing plans could you possibly have made over 2 months in advance? In the background on his end, she hears a gentle roar, a leaf blower or a passing truck. We're talking about going camping with Preston and Crosby in the Poconos. Alice plants her elbows on her desk and cradles the phone against her shoulder. I'm sorry, she says. Did I hear you right? I couldn't have. I actually couldn't have because what I thought you just said was that you were going to miss your sister's wedding to go gay camping in the Poconos. Half-sister, Paul corrects. I can't believe this. She pinches her eyes shut and wards off the beginnings of a flash migraine. I can't just drop everything every time Eloise decides to smother us with her own happiness, Alice. I have a life, you know. You're implying that I don't. I didn't say that. You didn't have to. That's what makes it an implication. There's a pause. Alice bookmarks the Bella Latera website, unbookmarks it, and then bookmarks it again before finally closing the window. She says, "Please, tell me you'll be there." "I need to think about it." "Paul," she says, trying not to plead, "tell me you'll be there." "I have to go. Paul, Alice, I'm leaving now." She leans forward and lowers her voice to a whisper. "So help me God, Paul, if you hang up on me, I'll fucking come for you." Alice hears Paul sigh dramatically, and the line goes dead.
Paul. May 3rd. "What's your anxiety level?"
"My God, this is disgusting."
"Yes, I imagine it is."
"No, but really, this is absolutely repulsive. It's like you can actually see the disease. There, look, right next to my pinky finger. Syphilis crawling around, having a grand old time."
This time, Paul doesn't answer.
Wendy shifts her hands along the flanks of the garbage can, but she doesn't let go. Earlier during their first session of the day, she'd kicked the steel bin away after 5 agonized seconds, and Dr. Goulding, Paul's supervisor, had demanded that Wendy pick up each piece of trash with her bare hands. 3 banana peels and a maxi pad later, she lost it, fell to the ground, and started pounding her fists against the pavement. She wailed so hard and so loud about the pervasiveness of germs that a group of patients inside took breaks from facing their own fears to huddle in one of the clinic's broad bay windows where they looked on, mouths agape. The only thing that got Wendy up was when Paul, playing the nice guy to Goulding's bad cop shtick, had leaned over and said, "You're doing great, Wendy. Just think of how filthy the ground must be." Now he hears himself ask again, "What's your anxiety level?"
"A 9? A 9.5? A 9.9?
She pinches her eyes shut, and Paul watches the metal fog up around her fingers as she grips the can tighter.
"What's higher than a 9.9?
"A 9.99, I guess.
Can I go to 2 decimal places? Can I go to 9.99?
Sweat beads in the shallow grooves of Wendy's temples, and tears balance just beneath her eyes. Paul lets his gaze fall back to his clipboard. This is the part he hates the most, the moment right before the panic begins to slowly subside. When the patient seems so sure that fear and her own frenetic synapses might cause her heart to burst. When Paul, despite his knowing better, is blindly certain that through some violent act of empathy, his own heart might burst as well. "You can say it's a 10, you know," he says.
"No, I can't."
"If it feels like it's a 10, you should say it's a 10. Wendy shakes her head. In the sun, the roots of her blonde hair are streaked with dull glints of gray.
"I can't handle a 10. If I say it's a 10, then I can't handle it. I want to handle it."
Paul tries to keep a straight face. Goulding throws a fit whenever one of his caseworkers reacts emotionally to something a patient says, but he can't help it. He grins as he jots down 9.99 on a line marked Compulsive Fear and Anxiety Control. He likes Wendy too much. Despite the fretful disposition, the need to wash her hands until they are blistered and red, the insistence on using a fresh toothbrush each night, there are other parts of Wendy that exist free of her compulsions, parts that Paul finds soothing. The frayed collars of her polo shirts, the chipped pearl earrings she wears every day, the creamy scent of the Yves Saint Laurent perfume that trails her around the clinic. All of it adds up to a sort of faded wasp aesthetic, like she's been plucked from a year-old Talbot's catalog. She reminds him, more or less, of the mothers of his wealthier friends from college, the sort of women who didn't visit campus, but instead dropped by, who insisted on buying him dinner and laughing at his jokes, who always offered him a hopeful, if not entirely sober, form of kinship. He often catches himself imagining that Wendy could be his own mother, if his mother were actually someone else entirely. She showed up at the clinic 2 months ago, at the forefront of a week-long rush of about 100 other prospective patients. They'd all seen Goulding on Good Morning America. "Which time?" he asked each of them, behind his clipboard. Paul rolled his eyes. Where he had been invited to discuss his latest book, Torturing Your Way to a Peaceful Mind. It was the third volume in a vague and loose-ish series. The first two, which had been required reading in the Master's in Psychology program at New York University.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.